Hello. Welcome to the final video in our GoJS beginner video series. This video will demonstrate how you can interact with an application that uses GoJS live in the console of your browser's developer toolkit. Using GoJS requires programming in JavaScript and familiarity with HTML and CSS. You will benefit from previously viewing the other videos in the beginner video series. In particular, you should be familiar with the concepts covered in the video, What's in a GoJS Application? This video references those topics frequently. For this video, we're going to be examining the GoJS minimal application sample. It looks like this, and its source code can be found in the sample section of gojs.net. There is also a link to this sample in the description below. Let's load the page in our browser. For this video, I'm using Google Chrome, but since GoJS works in virtually all modern browsers, you can use whatever browser you like. More importantly, you should use a browser whose development facilities you are familiar with, especially the console window and debugger. We'll be exploring how to interact with a GoJS application in the browser console window. Let's open up our browser's console window. For most browsers, this can be done with the F12 key. Here, we can type and interact with elements in our application. When developing your GoJS application, be sure to use the godebug.js library instead of the go.js library. The debug library does more error checking and can detect more unusual situations. Most of these warnings and errors are written to the console window, which can prove massively helpful for debugging. Since the GoJS diagram for this sample application is defined in code as my diagram without the var keyword, it is attached to the window object, and we can reference it in the console simply by typing my diagram. If we press enter after typing this, we see the window does know what this refers to, but the GoJS library is minified, so the properties are not understandable for a human. However, we can still have meaningful interaction with GoJS through the console if we refer to the API documentation and interface with properties and functions that return telling information. Let's start exploring our GoJS app with a simple task. Let's find out how many nodes are in our diagram. This can be accomplished with a call to mydiagram.nodes.count. How would we know to do this? If we look at the API documentation page for the diagram class on gojs.net, we see the nodes property returns an iterator containing all nodes in the diagram. Then, if we visit the iterator documentation page, we see all iterators support the count property. So, while a call to mydiagram.nodes returns something unintelligible due to the minification of the GoJS library, our reading of the documentation lets us know it's an iterator, and that iterator's count property will give us something we can understand. If we type mydiagram.nodes.count, we see it returns the number 4. This kind of interaction with the documentation is a skill that takes time to develop, but is well worth the effort, as it allows one to effectively explore and debug your GoJS applications. The remainder of this video makes use of methods and properties defined in the API documentation. We will not go over these methods and properties deeply in this video. It's recommended you explore the documentation to learn exactly what properties and functions GoJS supports. Let's see what kind of layout this diagram is using. We'll do this with a call to mydiagram.layout. We see again a minified GoJS object that doesn't give us much information. Often, we can try to get more information about a GoJS object just by calling its toString function. Let's try that. If we call mydiagram.layout.toString, we can see the string layout for diagram mydiagram_div. This tells us the diagram corresponding with the div mydiagram_div, that is, my diagram, is using an instance of the default layout class layout. In addition to observing properties of GoJS objects, we can also alter them from the console window. Suppose we want to alter our diagram's layout. Maybe we want to try out a grid layout and see how that looks. This can be done with a call to mydiagram.layout equals new go.gridLayout. The nodes are now arranged in a line, but we specified a grid layout. Why aren't they laid out in a grid? Again, this is where careful reading of the documentation is important. Let's take a look at the grid layout class in the documentation. It seems like we need to specify some property for the grid layout, called wrapping column, to set the maximum number of columns per row in the grid layout. Okay, let's go back and set the wrapping column to a value of 2, so that 2 nodes are in each row. We'll do this with a call to mydiagram.layout.wrappingColumn equals 2. Now, our 4 nodes are arranged in a nice looking 2x2 grid. In addition to examining and manipulating properties, the console window can be used to call GoJS functions. For example, the function diagram.layoutDiagram arranges its parts in accordance with the rules defined by the diagram's layout. Since we just set our diagram layout to a grid layout with a wrapping column of 2, a call to diagram.layoutDiagram should snap back all its nodes into a grid with rows of 2 nodes. Let's test this. Let's move around a few nodes so they're not in a grid formation. Now, let's call my diagram.layoutDiagram. Nothing happened. Why? Let's head over to the documentation page for diagram and see what it has to say about the layout diagram function. Looks like we need to specify a Boolean parameter called invalidateAll. It seems if we set this to true, all the layouts for the diagram and its groups will be made invalid and be laid out. And if we set it to false, which is the default value, only elements with invalid layouts will be laid out again. But what does it mean for a layout to be valid or invalid? And how does a layout become invalid? Learning to find answers to these kinds of questions is an important skill. In this instance, looking through the GoJS documentation, or even just doing a Google search for GoJS invalid layout, will quickly show that a layout becomes invalid under different conditions, depending on the kind of layout it is. However, simply moving some nodes, as we did in our diagram, does not invalidate a layout. So, if we go back to the console and call myDiagram.layoutDiagram false, nothing happens. The function is only laying out elements whose layouts are invalid, and the grid layout we applied to our diagram is not invalid currently, since we only moved some nodes. As such, we should pass true as the parameter for the layoutDiagram function, as this will invalidate all layouts, forcing them to be laid out again. So, if we try myDiagram.layoutDiagram true, we finally get the result we want. The nodes all snap back into the grid formation. We can store a GoJS object reference in a variable in our console window to easily access it later. Say we want to remember this orange node. Let's select it in the diagram, then call myDiagram.selection.first. If we want to make sure it's a node, we can input the same command and add a .toString function call. To remember that node object, we simply set some variable to it. Let's call that variable myNode. Now if we call myNode.toString, we see we get the same result as before, but with less typing. Remembering object references in the console helps us explore and debug GoJS applications without the need for long code stringing together many properties and functions. Let's go ahead and manipulate this node's data. If you've seen our video, The GoJS Diagram Model, you're familiar with the idea that node objects and node appearance is separate from its data. We can access the node's data object with a call to .data. So if we call myNode.data, we can see what data it has. Let's say we want to change its color data property. There is a binding in the node template for this sample that binds the fill of the shape element of a node to its color data property. As we can see, the current color data property value for the beta node is orange, and the beta node's shape appears with an orange fill. So, one might expect if we change the color data property value for this node, the shape's fill would change as well. Let's try it. Set myNode.data.color to a new value, say red. Nothing happened. Why? If we examine myNode's data object, we see the color data property does indeed now have the value red. So why is the appearance not updated? The data binding object that binds the color data property to the shape element's fill property was not notified of the change. To do this, we must call the updateTargetBindings function on the node. So if we enter myNode.updateTargetBindings into the console window, we achieve our desired result. The beta node now has its shape element's fill property set to red. An alternate, simpler way to do this would be to use the model.set function. If you've seen our video, The GoJS Diagram Model, you're already familiar with this function. It takes 3 parameters. The data object in the model we're going to manipulate, the key of the data property we're going to manipulate, and the value to set that data property to. So, we could update the appearance of the beta node again in a single line. We'd start with myDiagram.model to get the model of the diagram so we can call the set function. We'd add that function, then pass myNode.data as the first parameter, as that's the data object in the model we're going to manipulate. Then color as the key for the data property we want to manipulate in the first parameter, then whatever string we want to set the color data property to for the third parameter. Let's set the color data property back to orange. We press enter, and immediately the beta node appearance is updated. This is because the set function both updates model data and notifies all relevant data bindings of the data change. Exactly how this works can be seen in the documentation. In addition, This function makes these changes in a way that can be undone or redone, so it is generally preferable to use it when manipulating model data. There are many more ways to interact with GoJS applications by use of the console window, but for now, this is enough. A good general rule of thumb is that when something doesn't work as expected, refer to the documentation. GoJS.net has the full documentation for GoJS, as well as dozens of other pages to act as helpful resources. Additionally, we pride ourselves on developer-to-developer support, both via email and forum, so there will virtually never be an obstacle you can't overcome. Head over to GoJS.net to see hundreds of samples, read more about GoJS features on the intro pages, or peruse the full API documentation. Sign up for an unlimited free trial, and you'll get 30 days of developer-to-developer support for free.